I'm going to give you some help doing the Unit 2 Part B questions because I've marked a lot of things recently and I think some of you are getting the hang of how to do them, but not all of you. So I think I need to give you a bit more advice, and hopefully by giving you this recorded advice you can watch it at home and you can pause bits or you can replay bits, and you know, hopefully that will help you remember and make the whole process a bit easier. What you have with these Unit 2 Part B questions is they always ask you, this is the one you did recently about revolution in the art of warfare, they always ask you, do you agree with a view? And in this case, the question was, do you agree with the view that the Great War resulted in, quote, a revolution in the art of warfare for the British Army? And that's a direct quote from one of the sources, says which source it comes from. You always have to explain your answer using the sources that are provided and your own knowledge, okay? Now, the first one of these you did was about Florence Nightingale, and the question was, do you agree with the view that it was largely as a result of the work of Florence Nightingale that medical care for British soldiers improved during the Crimean War? When we sent you that essay, I gave you this handout that said planning method on it. And I think one of the problems that I've found in marking the ones about the First World War is that some of you just didn't follow this planning method. So I'm going to go through it again now, and hopefully you'll see by the process that I go through with the First World War one how to do better with these types of questions. Okay, here we go. The planning method says that you should choose from some evidence from the sources that supports the view in the question and some evidence from the sources that challenges the view in the question. So let's do that first of all. You've got to use sources 7, 8 and 9. Now this bit of it, most of you don't really have too many problems with this. But I'll go over it again anyway. A good approach to this is to have two different coloured pens or to draw a column, to draw a table with two columns. And what you do, if you're going to draw a table with two columns, is what's the evidence, evidence that supports the view, and what's the evidence that challenges the view in the question. And clearly the view in this question is that the Great War resulted in a revolution in the art of warfare. So, source 7. Does it support or challenge the view? The attack gave striking proof of the enormous advance made by the new British Army in the technique of warfare. Well, that does seem to support the view that there was a revolution, there was an enormous advance in the technique of warfare. Because it was a masterpiece achieved with one-tenth of the casualties it would have cost us in 1916. Well, that's a revolution. If you can do the same thing, but with only 10% of the casualties, that seems to be pretty revolutionary. The artillery fired numerous intermittent bombardments, and their support at 0 hour, 0 hour means when the attack actually commences, was arranged to appear merely a repetition of one of these. Now that is revolutionary, because previously what had happened was that the bombardments had gone ahead and then they'd paused and then the offensive took place. But here what's happening is the support at 0 hour, that's when the offensive begins, that appears to be a repetition of a bombardment. Well, that's a new way of doing things. It's a new way of doing things in terms of tactics. What's this source talking about? It's talking about tactics. That's the other thing you have to do. You have to look for what the sources are actually about. Well, this source is about tactics and about how they've improved. The bombardment didn't indicate the time or direction of the attack, and under cover of darkness, the enemy's defences were taken, the whole affair being a complete surprise. Well, That does support the view in the question that there was a revolution, because previously one of the big problems that the British Army had was that their tactics were predictable. The Germans knew that as soon as the bombardment finished, that it meant that there was going to be an advance by the British troops. So, source 7 definitely supports the view in the question in terms of the tactics used. I can't really see anything in source 7 that suggests that anything other, really. We also have to consider the provenance of the source. And as you might be able to see, remember if you look at your one, source 7 is from the memoirs of a captain called D. Kelly, published in 1930. He'd fought on the Somme in 1916, and here he describes an attack near Amiens on the 1st of September 1918. So this is someone who was there at the time. He had the ability to see what was going on. Because he's a captain, he's involved in the British offensives. He has some expertise on the subject. But he's a captain. He's a British captain. He's perhaps not that neutral. He's perhaps, we don't know this for definite, for sure, but he's perhaps going to highlight the successes the British Army had. He's got a career in the army, he had a career in the army. Perhaps he has a slightly vested interest in promoting the successes of the British Army. Perhaps 12 years after the war, the worse elements of the war have perhaps receded from his mind a little bit. Perhaps he's inclined to put a slightly rosy view on things that have happened. So we've got to bear that in mind when thinking about his evidence that he's giving. Has he got a vested interest? Now, we only do that process, we only think about the provenance of the sources when we're looking at contemporary evidence, sources, source material from the time. We don't really need to do that for the secondary evidence, i.e. historians' evidence, because, well, basically we don't know. I mean, I think we have to assume that if a historian has had a book published on something, that they've been professional, you know, that they've tried to be as objective and balanced as possible, that they've consulted all the sources. And I think there has to be a certain amount of trust, I suppose, that the historian has done a good job. Although occasionally, and only occasionally, there might be some clues in maybe the title of their book that give away that perhaps they might have an agenda. For example, source 10 here, source 9 rather, by John Laffin, the title of his book is British Butchers and Bunglers of World War I. Well, I mean, the title of the book tells you everything you need to know, really. He's setting out to write a book about all the, what would seem to be, the people who did everything wrong in the First World War. So it might seem with him that he has a bit of an agenda. But the other source from Gordon Corrigan's book, Mud, Blood and Poppycock, a bit hard to tell, really, if he has an agenda. So we'll leave that for now. Anyway, going back to the sources, we have to use source 7, 8 and 9 and own knowledge. So we've looked at 7, let's have a look at source 8. Source 8 says, far from being simply a series of mindless frontal assaults by massed infantry, the Great War was in reality a revolution in the art of warfare. Oh, well, that's where the quote in the question has come from. Of course he's going to support the view in the question, isn't he? He's the one that's putting forward the view in the question. But what's he talking about? Because you have to think what the source is talking about. He says there were huge advances in technology. Tanks, mechanical transport, indirect fire by artillery, trench mortars, gas, portable machine guns, all owe their development to the war. There's a clear emphasis in this source on technology. That seems to be what he's talking about. All these innovations, well, innovations are new things, you know, new things, revolutionary, were seized on and developed by the very generals who are supposed to have been so resistant to change? He is basically attacking the myth that the leaders of the British Army were conservative and stuck in their ways and resistant to change. And he's challenging that. He's saying it's not a series of mindless frontal assaults. Actually, there's a revolution in terms of technology. So Source 8 very much supports the view in the question in terms of technology.